Hi,
we're glad you're here. We just said all kinds of stuff that was really great. Sorry you missed it. We're going to begin this session with a video that you should be able to see on Google Hangouts. It is a YouTube video, and it's sort of an interview format from a professor and Episcopal minister from the UK, Tom Greggs, who talks about Bonhoeffer, and I think you'll find it to be very helpful. If you're interested in really, more footage and really kind of getting into his life beyond just having one commentator on camera, there are a couple of options. One is, and you can find it on YouTube, and you can also order it from a variety of places. There are films on Bonhoeffer. One is called Bonhoeffer. It's made by Journey Films. It's really quite excellent. There's another one called Hanged on a Twisted Cross, which is long. It's narrated by, I can't think of his name, from the Mary Tyler Moore Show. No, he was the boss. Ed Asner narrates it. But there's also the dramatic film, Bonhoeffer, Agent of Grace, which is was a two-part on PBS. It was produced by some people who really understood Bonhoeffer, and did a really fine job. So if you're looking for something that's a little bit more about his family background and about how all of this went, the commentator mentions the 1944 July 20th plot against Hitler. That's the film Valkyrie, the Tom Cruise film. But Bonhoeffer was not, he was already in prison when that assassination attempt was made. The attempt that he was more actively involved in was back in 1943. But once the July 20th failed attempt on Hitler occurred, that was where they uncovered the information that Bonhoeffer was not just a resistor, but had been part of a treasonous conspiracy to take down the dictator. And that was what really sealed his fate and moved him from just being locked up to being someone who was on his way to the gallows under Hitler. A couple of things that I want to just reflect on, and then I want to give a little time for questions that you may have, both on what you've seen here and maybe what you've already read or have wondered about Bonhoeffer. One of the things you're going to be confronted with in the book, I think, right away, is the sort of the critique of a dead church. The idea that there is this ossified institution that is dispensing forgiveness to people without authentic repentance and is just demanding of people that they simply become Christians in name only, nominal Christians who worship on Sunday and then go right back to living compliant lives and allowing the state to do whatever it pleases, even if the things that the state pleases are things that ought to be against the ethics or what's the right and wrong that Christians would understand. Now, that has very fertile ground within the story of the Third Reich in the mid to late 1930s and onward, but it also has relevance for us as well. When you read the section that I'm going to ask you to read for next week, which is the first section, and I'll give you the particular four sections that I'd like you to read, that's where Bonhoeffer talks about cheap grace versus costly grace. And I've read the book enough times now to know that I rarely think about Nazi Germany when I'm reading those parts. Instead, I'm thinking about my own life and faith and thinking about how many times I have just kind of parroted along, we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves, sin against you in thought, word, and deed, blah, 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 blah. Your sins are washed away. Great. Now what do we do? Move on. The next hymn. As opposed to a sort of a deep participation in the ministry of forgiveness and of confession, forgiveness, and renewal that then leads to something. And what does it lead to? It leads to engagement out there in the world. In a certain sense, it leads to what we say at the end of every worship service here at First Lutheran. And again, these words can become nothing but words if we let them to, allow them to. This worship is ended. You could almost say to rest.
And the service goes on in the
now
world.
Now the service goes on where?
In the world.
In the world. And now if we really took those words seriously, that sending forth into the world. What that means is not just in the world, it means in the workplace, in family, in the voting booth, in our engagement, on the picket line, and out there in wherever it is that Christ is calling us to stand for the gospel as we understand it, to sin boldly in the service of the gospel in the places to which God has called us. And I want to say a word about why that would have been so important for Bonhoeffer and why we got to be a little careful that we don't just sort of play into the, I hope I'm not being defensive here, but that we don't just play into the, oh yeah, he's just bashing the church. There's always plenty to bash about the church in every generation. But you need to understand what it was to be in the German Lutheran church or the Evangelische Kirche, which wasn't just Lutheran but also Reformed. It was sort of everybody who wasn't Catholic in Germany was part of the Evangelische Kirche, which was the Reformed Church. The anyone who was not under the papacy was Evangelische, or of the evangelists. And that's as old a division as Luther, but it was really big. And in Germany in the late 19th century and early 20th century, you couldn't really be just Lutheran. You were part of this Evangelische Kirche that was a mixed marriage and an uncomfortable mixed marriage between Presbyterians and Reformed and Lutherans. They didn't always get along together because the only thing they had in common was how they felt about the papacy. Not even their own theology, like Calvinists versus Lutherans. But what had happened in the 19th century is that the church had become really rather ossified and stoic. It was a literal state church, which for many Americans is not something that we've ever really experienced. Even Episcopalians, you know, that some of the trappings of the state church, the cathedrals, the stone walls and all of that, the sort of thing we pray for the queen or the king, we can't really understand it. We've got to kind of walk around Germany and get a sense. Did you hear the part about being a public servant, a civil servant? To be a theologian and a pastor in Germany in the late 19th century and into the 20th century was to draw your pay from the state. And people were not making voluntary free will offerings on Sunday. They were being taxed by the state, and a percentage was going to the church. It was a church tax. And still is in some places, although, you know, in some parts of Europe that's loosening up and there are more options, you know, if people want to break away from that. The idea that it was hard to see the kind of vitality of saying the church lives its life under the lordship of Christ and not under the lordship of the state. I had an example of this. I don't know how you feel about national flags in sanctuaries. And I know I've known a few people in my life. In fact, in my last synod, I was the guy after 9/11 that had to go around to churches on behalf of my bishop, because all those national flags that had been outside the sanctuaries were being moved back in. Because after 9/11, there was this surge of nationalism and patriotism and all, let's get those flags back in there. You know, and I was the guy that went, I brought with me pictures that I had of some of the German churches from the mid-1930s where swastika flags were hung up behind the altar. And nobody, I mean, we see it now when we go like this, but they saw it in the 30s as it was simply a reflection of we're Germans, we're Christians. That's why the German Evangelische Kirche was called the Deutsche Kirche. It was the German church. I grew up in a church that originally its name was Christ Evangelical German Lutheran Church. Maybe some of you grew up in churches that had the word Norwegian or Swedish or something. It was probably Bethel. The Bethel Swedish, you know, and because the ethnicity, the stateness of it was right in there with the faithness of it. And it's something that many Americans find, you know, to be something we couldn't really even quite get our minds around. What do you mean? That these are not voluntary associations under the gospel with their own rules on the outside of the control of the state? Well, no. Not only were they within the state, but they also had become kind of captive to the idea that don't expect the rush of the Spirit in your church. You know, this was the same period, late 19th century and into the 20th, where the political theories of Karl Marx, as much as you may not like Marxism, you have to kind of hear the critique that that religion in Europe had become what he called the drug of the masses, the opiate of the commoners. So people don't rise up and seek liberty and seek justice and seek fairness and all this because they are told, don't worry, you're going to get pie in the sky in the great by and by. So don't object. And this was rampant within European state Christianity. There's one other thing, and then I'll pause. The other thing was the Enlightenment. From the 18th into the 19th century, was this idea that the world, that the negative, that people are essentially sinful and are depraved wills and all of this, needed to give way to a more enlightened view of the human being. Humanism, that people could be educated and cultivated and civilized out of their baser nature and could achieve God consciousness. This was the European religion of the 19th century. It's something that many of us would not find at all recognizable, and maybe you would say, well, I think I might hear that at the Ethical Culture Society, or I might hear that at the Unitarian Church. I don't want to pick on the Unitarians, but I'm not going to hear that at my Lutheran Church. Well, in the 19th century, it was everywhere in Europe. Guess what changed it? World War I. All of a sudden, people were seeing photographs. Like in the U.S., we saw the photographs, some of us anyway, saw the photographs of Civil War battlefields. And what was brought home was the savagery of war and the inhumanity of people toward one another. And so when people saw the pictures of the trenches and they saw that this one was gassing the other and back and forth and the horrendous character of it, the theologian Karl Barth, B-A-R-T-H, it looks like Barth, but it's Barth, was the first to write about this and to say, we have been wrong. We have been the same filthy sinners all along. We've just been dressing ourselves up as civilized, progressive, and enlightened. But when it really comes down to it, it's Cain and Abel. And it has not changed. And that was a seismic change in Europe. And it's no accident that Bonhoeffer respected and read Karl Barth and was part of an entire kind of revolutionary, transformative movement in theology in Europe that said, we've been wrong all along. We've been pretending that we can educate our way out of the muck. And guess what? We're right in there, and we've always been in there. And let's look anew at what St. Paul had to say about the cross. And let's look anew at what it is to be the old Adam. And in fact, let's look at what Luther had to say. All of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That was not popular to say in the 19th century, right up until 1914. And then all of a sudden people were looking at it again and saying, wow, we have been kidding ourselves all along. So that's what Bonhoeffer came up through. And can you imagine what a challenge that would be to the established church? That was saying just pay and pray and shut up. And now you've got these radicals who are going off and conducting seminaries that are not under the official aegis of the university system. And now they're out there holding spiritual renewal weekends. And now people are beginning to ask questions about the spirit and about change. And they're beginning to question the principle of the Kaiser Fuhrer. About the monarchy, that whoever is on top of the heap must be obeyed without question. And that became the fabric of this great battle in the 30s, and once war was announced, and once those who were not only objecting to the Fuhrer principle, but seeking to bring down the regime, had to answer some pretty tough questions that you are going to find in the book about. Does one take up arms, as you heard the commentator say, is it better to do evil than to be evil?
Yeah.
Or to say, is it enough to decry the cart that is running people over, or to drive a spoke through the wheel? In other words, do we just stand on the sidelines and watch it happen, while our neighbors are being hauled off to concentration camps and are being denied their basic rights and are being demeaned and treated cruelly, or do we get involved? even at the risk of making mistakes, even at the risk of maybe even violating our own principles, and Bonhoeffer's case, pacifism, being one of them. Yes?
And was the church during that time political, not religious?
I think it was both. Bonhoeffer would say the problem was that it was religious. It was structured around a kind of a formalism of religion. You know, it was very religious. He would say the problem is it's religious, not faithful. The problem is it's all structured about its hymnals and about its officialdom and about who's the bishop and who's the pastors and preachers and who gets the choice assignments and all that sort of thing, and it's not living out its faith. And in his book, living out its faith would have been standing up against this rising regime that many of them felt to be anti-Christian. And believe me, many, if not most of them, saw that it was only the most naive could think that the Hitler regime was in any sense of the word Christian. It tipped its cap to Christianity, especially early on. Hitler was a very good pedagogue about that. But finally, it wasn't a Christianity that anybody would recognize. So they were religious all over the place. He would say they just weren't faithful. Yeah, they'd given into the formalism of their faith rather than the heart and soul of it.
So it wasn't a church of faith.
Well, let's start reading. Let me not tell you what Bonhoeffer thinks. I'll let you discover it in there and see what some of the challenges might be and how we can read it in our own day too. The point of this is not just a history lesson of the 1930s. It really isn't. But I want to lay that out because it gets very easy for us to just race into our own context and forget what the original setting really was for the writing of this, what Bonhoeffer had in his mind before we think about what we have in our mind. Yes?
I've been sitting here and everything has gone from 1530 to 1940. If you think about the parallels that are going on with what happened with Bonhoeffer and the persecution of the church and Luther and the persecution of the church and Luther fighting with Rome, Bonhoeffer fighting with the Nazi church, and everything, the parallels are like checkoff points as you go along here.
Yeah.
Luther in the fortress and Bonhoeffer in the prison, both of them in small cells, both of them writing in these areas. I mean, you know, it's there. I mean, and it's just something that struck me.
I'm really glad you shared it, because what you're going to see in the readings for next Wednesday is that Bonhoeffer does an extended reflection on recapturing what he sees as Luther's insight about grace and faith and discipleship, that you can see the honor that he has for Luther. So I want to say something about hypocrisy in light of that, because I don't want somebody to throw it up in my face, so I'll throw it out in your faces first. Martin Luther absolutely touched off the fuse that lit the Reformation and was all about Christian freedom. In fact, early in his career, he was also combated some of the latent anti-Semitism in 16th century Germany with a pamphlet called That Jesus Christ Was Born a Jew, where he talks about how important it is to remember that Jesus was Jewish, you know, and that how indebted we are to our Jewish cousins for the coming of the Christ. And yet, by the early 1540s, 3 years or so before his death, he could write a terrible polemic called On the Jews and Their Lies that was not, strictly speaking, an anti-Semitic treatise as much as it was a criticism of what he saw as some things that he had heard were being said in synagogues in Germany. But it still laid out some very harsh remedies against these synagogues, and he was remembered, Luther was remembered, and some of his most unfortunate writings late in his career were picked up and used by the Nazis and had been used for 400 years after Luther. So, you know, Luther proved his own point about being captive to sin. And so did Bonhoeffer. You heard the part about Bonhoeffer refusing to take that funeral. There's no other explanation. And in his biographies, it's very clear. It was not politic for him to do it. And so he did. Now, can you imagine turning down the funeral for that relative? An ethnic Jew who, according to the Aryan clause, was a Jew. He'd have been baptized 25 times over. He would have been a Jew. Because that was what the Aryan setup was all about. It was about your bloodline. It was not about your faith. But he didn't take that funeral. He walked away from that funeral. And it has been a source of embarrassment. It was in his own life, but it has been a source of embarrassment for him. You heard the part about him joining the Abwehr, the OSS of the Germans there. Well, a part of it that you need to know is that he was trying to avoid being drafted. There was universal conscription in the late 1930s in Germany. It was put in place, and everybody his age was going to have to go sign up, and guess where they were going to go? Well, eventually they were going to go to the Eastern Front. You know, they were going to go wherever the fighting was. And so Bonhoeffer and his circle, they were very elitist. They were the upscale intelligentsia. They didn't want to go fight. They were looking for a way out. And Canada was too far. No, I made that. So the Abwehr was a way for him to continue to be part of the struggle, but it was also a way to avoid military service. It was a way to avoid conscription. When he went to New York, he really did go there with the idea that it would be safer for him to go and teach and then come back later. And it was a bout of conscience that got him to get back on that ship and go back to Germany because he realized that he was being a coward. Something that I think almost any of us would have done. We would have taken the pledge, yeah, I love Hitler, and just gotten back to our work and said, it's okay, you know, I don't really feel that way, but I'll sign, and it'll be easy. You know, what is the force of conscience? What happens to a person like Bonhoeffer where he says, I'll have no right to be part of the rebuilding of my country if I ditch my country until the last gunshot, and then I come back. I got to go back. I know it's going to happen, but I got to go back. And it wasn't easy, and he agonized over it, and he had lots of friends who said, you're crazy. You're crazy. You're going to end up in the camps. And of course, he did. Let me say a quick... Oh, we're almost done. I'm sorry. Let me open up for other things that... questions that may have come up for you, either as you were watching the video or just, I don't know, just a stray wonderment. Yes, Nicole.
I thought it was fascinating when he was considering suicide so that he would protect his friends and other people. That he would.
Yeah. And he really struggled with it because of the idea of, you know, his own ethics. You know, a lot of us, especially in the 2020 of hindsight about Hitler, you know, sliding a bomb under Hitler's chair. They're at the Wolf's Lair. Go! Yay! Go for it. This was a coup d'etat. This was toppling a head of state. This was a violation of the commandment. And this guy is a pacifist. He agonized over whether it would be right to break the commandment against thou shalt not murder. He agonized over his own self murder. And yes, the idea is, you know, sooner or later they're going to come in and they're going to pull out your nails and you're going to tell them everything you know, and I better take my own life before I let that happen. But it was also that he was so miserable and depressed, not only being imprisoned and then being imprisoned by the Gestapo, which is different than being imprisoned by the military, but then knowing that what awaited him would have, you know, I'd rather take my own life than live through that. So, next week, I hope this has been helpful. You know, not knowing how much background you all have had on Bonhoeffer, I think you need to know, because you're going to read some of this stuff in the book, and you're going to say, oh my goodness, I can't believe he wrote this 8 years before his death. He was in a certain sense, writing his own epitaph in terms of the implications of what's in here. But I thought it would be important for you to know that. Now, what I'm going to ask you to read is about 100 pages. And it's dense, as one of you was saying, oh my God, you know, you just, you read, you say, I think I better go back and read that again.
Yeah,
I think I started looking out the window at some point, because I don't know what I read. Feel free to read the foreword and the memoir and all that. The memoir is pretty turgid, though, and that's one reason why I showed you this. I would really recommend that, unless you're a real bibliophile and really want to read every last scrap, get to Bonhoeffer. You know, so read from the introduction on 35 through 102. So it's section one, Grace and Discipleship. And if you end up getting this book, it'll be the same place. It's the first section, okay? There are actually five subheads under this, and they are Costly Grace, The Call to Discipleship, Single-Minded Obedience, Discipleship and the Cross, Discipleship and the Individual. They should be the same in all of the editions, maybe with slight variations in this one, which is a newer, more updated translation. It'll give you a lot to think about. The best thing, especially with a group this size, for which I'm really grateful, would be take notes. Especially take notes of what makes your head spin. You know, take notes of those things that say, wow, what does he mean by this? He is a theologian, after all. He was trained, and so he's kind of up there in the ivory tower, and once in a while we're going to need to make him walk down the circular stairs and get down here with us in the refectory, you know, down here at ground level. Although, let me not scare you off. It'll get there. It'll get under your skin. Especially the section on cheap grace versus costly grace. And we're going to try to lay that out and contrast the two. What does that really mean? And what does it really mean for us? Okay? Thanks for your bravery. See you next week.